Today's visitor is very exciting because he was actually the inspiration for Tally Talks. Last year, we had a select committee on healthcare, and Chairman Sprouls invited Dr. Marty Makary to come and speak. And he gave us all a book. He gave us his book, and after reading this book, I could not believe what was in it. And then the doctor came up and spoke in committee, and like most testimonies in committee, it's a few minutes, you really can't get anything said, and off he went. And I thought to myself, why can't we have some sort of forum where we could really have a conversation and really get into what's in this book, because it is shocking what's here. And it's not material that's refuted, by the way. And so we had this idea to do this way. So, Doctor, it's so great to have you here, and thank you so much for writing this book.
Great to be with you. Thanks for inviting me.
So I want to list a couple of the things. I tried to take this to memory, but it is impossible to take to memory everything that the good doctor does. And so I just want to mention a couple. He's a surgical director of the Johns Hopkins Multidisciplinary Pancreas Clinic and the chief of minimally invasive, boy, Jason really got into detail here, pancreatic surgery at Johns Hopkins Hospital. He's a professor at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, and he's a pioneer of pancreas operations at Johns Hopkins and one of the few highest volume laparoscopic pancreas surgeons in the United States. He earned his degree at Thomas Jefferson University and completed his residency in general surgery at Georgetown University Medical Center. He's a fellow of the American College of Surgeons and has served in leadership roles at the United Nations World Health Organization Safe Surgery Saves Lives Initiative. And he was named one of America's 40 smartest people in healthcare by Becker Magazine in 2014. In addition to that, he appears on CNN regularly. He has testified before Congress. And of course, he wrote this great book. And so, on top of the fact that you've made us feel like underachievers already, Doc, I want to cover the different things in the book, but you open this book in a way that just kind of hits you in the face with a story. And that story is about Hodad. Can you walk us through the story of Hodad and what the real premise of the book is?
Sure. Well, first of all, great to be with you and great to see so many familiar faces. I love Florida. I always enjoy coming to Florida, and it's great to see so many friends here and make new friends. Hodad is an interesting phenomenon. Hodad is was the doctor I was told I'm going to be working with when I was rotating at Harvard Medical School, and I didn't really know what Hodad meant, and then I had sort of witnessed this guy who was incredibly good-looking, but then when I asked one of my colleagues, what does Hodad stand for, they told me, Hands of Death and Destruction. And I thought, gosh, you know, is he really that bad? But the guy was amazing at the bedside. Could give a personal touch, would always, you know, patients appreciate a touch, and they'd put his hand on the patient's shoulder, and there was this incredible connection he made with patients. And then the operating room came. And in that operating room, people would start talking, the nurses would start talking, the scrub techs would start talking, the anesthesiologists would roll their eyes, the circulator in the room would start looking at the clock before the operation started. And quickly, I saw what they were talking about. And it was a very difficult sight to watch. The operation was done with poor technique, took far longer than necessary, required more blood transfusions than somebody would typically need. And I understood finally what they were talking about when they said they nicknamed him Hodad. He didn't know that. Now, I wrote about Hodad in the most, lawyers helped depersonalize, anonymize him in the book so that there's no way Hodad could be traced. I mean, they changed the color of his hair in the book. The lawyers came back and said, now, tell us something you know he was not. I said, well, he's not from this part of the country. And they even, you know, his real name in the book, which was also anonymized, was the name of a city. So if somebody ever Googled that name, they would get a city and they wouldn't get... Yeah, I mean, the lawyers made it so hard to de-identify him.
I know, because I tried to find him.
But everywhere I go around the country, we did a lot of rotations as students. People come up to me and they say, how did you know about our about HODAD at our hospital? And it turns out it's a term used in almost every hospital.
It's a franchise.
It's a franchise.
Well, so all right. So that's an example of breaking an idea that we have that, you know, obviously all doctors are great and they're all good people and they're all trying to do the right thing. It just doesn't necessarily mean they do. So here's another shocking statistic. That is a confirmed statistic. The Medical Institute agrees by it, at least its range. 250,000 people a year die at the hands of a doctor because of a medical mistake. That makes it the third leading cause of death in the United States. That's a shocking, shocking statistic. How come more people don't know about this?
Well, I think it's important, I think, for me to say, first of all, most doctors are doing the right thing and try to every time. But the system fails sometimes. Things go wrong. Medical care goes wrong. Complications of unnecessary surgery done in somebody with a gray line indication that really shouldn't have surgery, that was preventable. Somebody that had excessive surgery, somebody that fell through the cracks, somebody that was in a limited insurance network and couldn't get the right care, under-treatment, over-treatment, too many medications, prescribing errors. All of these things together are under the banner of medical care gone wrong. That's the term I've used in the medical literature when we wrote the paper describing it as the third leading cause of death, and that's the term I've used in the Wall Street Journal and in the media. And the reason I'm particular about that terminology is that we have a way in healthcare of coming up with sterilizing terminology that removes the problem from us. We don't call it we call it a healthcare cost. We don't call it medical price, right? If I told you petroleum commodities, the futures are increasing, that doesn't mean anything as if I told you gas prices are going up. We need to call it what it is. In medicine, we call these things preventable adverse events. Okay, and what they are mistakes. Now, they're not individual. Doctors are not bad people. We're talking about medical care goes wrong for any one of a number of factors. Instead of talking about the, we talk about the charge to cost ratio at a hospital. Okay, we're now changing the terminology to call it a markup. That's what it is, right? It's a markup. The charge to cost ratio. I mean, just we've created this lexicon that makes a very simple concept of taking care of sick people into this depersonalized, detached business that nobody can really understand. We've seen that before. We've seen it with credit default swaps. We've seen it with collateral debt obligations.
We see it with surcharges and fees that are really just taxes.
So I think that lexicon is valuable. Now, the paper that generated so much buzz and ended up in 2016 as the number two red paper in all of science was our paper saying that medical care gone wrong, if it were a disease, would rank as the third leading cause of death. And we did no original research on that paper. All we did was collect all the best studies, all the best evidence, and said, if you took this number and just put it on the CDC rank list, this is where it would fall. It would fall between number two. Number one is heart disease, two is cancer, and number three, which is a far number three, is chronic obstructive and chronic pulmonary disease. Well, nobody really knew what was three, and all you have to do is put it on in the context of the problem and use the right lexicon, and it turns out that we harm people in the process of trying to help them. People die or get seriously hurt not from the illness that brings them to care, but from the care that they receive. That's a hard problem. When you see that as a doctor, it wears on your morals and your ethics. When we go into this profession, 90% of the students we interview for medical school, we ask them, why do you want to be a doctor? You know what they tell us? because I want to be a missionary or serve the poor in some capacity, if not full-time, as a part of a medical practice. And, you know, I meet great docs all the time. Dr. Pigman, you meet doctors all the time. They're trying to help people out of the goodness of their heart with great intentions. They come in creative, bright. These students are the top of their class. They're, you know, they're the cream of the crop of America's universities. I mean, one kid we interviewed, he was like Surgeon General of Nicaragua for 2 years, applying for medical school. I mean, he's, you know, we have these incredible, talented, young, bright people. The sort of kid in high school, when you say, what do you want to do? And they say, I'm thinking about becoming a nurse. They're different from their peers. There's a sense of mission in healthcare, and it's an awesome sense of mission. I'm proud of it. It's an incredible heritage. But you take those kids and you put them through 4 years of teaching them a new vocabulary, and then another 4 years where they are forced to put their heads to the paper, and then another 5 years of surgical training, and then in our field, we do another 2 years, and if you do transplant or surgical oncology, my area, another 2 years, plus often 3 years of research. They come out different people. I mean, they're different people. There's a new ethics system, a new value-based lexicon. There's a new language, probably the equivalent of 7 foreign languages. And we look at these folks and we see burnout at all-time high rates. A third of doctors burned out, according to the Mayo Clinic study, and numerous other studies have affirmed that number. A third of doctors burned out. Entitlement, people struggling with their own personal lives as they wrestle with the ethics of what they see with medical care gone wrong. We need to help these people. These are not the villains. This is the byproduct of our system. They're doing what we've asked them to do. It's just this, the jobs are created inappropriately, and the job we're asking them to do is a tough job. So we have this endemic problem that nobody really is talking about. I see it all the time. I live in Washington, D.C. I think half my neighborhood ran for president this year, including one of my own partners in our surgical group ran for president. And people are talking about different ways to pay for health care. They're not really talking about how to fix the healthcare. We need to not just talk about different ways of paying for the broken healthcare system. We need to talk about how to fix the broken healthcare system. And in order to get at that, we have to finally start talking about this underlying problem of the HODADs. And I like to do it this way. And the guy that puts in 5 stents, cardiac stents, uniformly, whereas the national average is 2/10 of 1 stent on average gets put into a patient. So these extreme outliers, I think, represent the endemic problem in healthcare that really is driving the cost crisis, and that's unwarranted clinical variation.
So let's dive down into it in a practical way. So I think we have an understanding of where the problem lies, and we agree with you. We struggle up here as it takes 1/3 of our budget and growing. The question is always, how do we pay? Where do we find more money? The question, and certainly it's not that it isn't our question. We ask it yearly. How do we bring down the cost? But naturally, the incentives are in the wrong place. So let's talk about that a moment, the mechanics of it. So if someone goes in for a gallbladder surgery, today technology allows for laparoscopic gallbladder removal. Who decides what procedure is used to remove that gallbladder?
It's the individual surgeon discretion. And there was a guy in my training that we had a reputation. I was on call one night in the emergency room, and a patient came in and needed a routine operation. It was a hernia, ventral hernia. And it was a classic presentation for what can be handled laparoscopically. Minimally invasive incisions, 3 small incisions, patients go home the same day. And I started to explain to the patient what they were going to have done. You're going to have 3 small incisions, you're going to go home tomorrow morning just because it's getting kind of late in the day, your pain will be alleviated, you'll be on this pain medication, you'll follow up in 2 weeks. And I knew that I knew that a doctor was on call who was very good at doing this operation. Well, I go over to the call schedule to look up his number on the call sheet, and I realize, oh my gosh, his shift ended at 7 p.m. It's 9 p.m., and this guy who, if I can share his nickname,
yes,
we called him Shrek. I didn't come up with the name. That's what all the residents called him and the nurses called him. Not to his face, I'm sure. Okay? Shrek is on call. Shrek likes to cut everybody open like a trout. That's the way Shrek likes to do it. That's the way he does his operation. Sure enough, I go back to the patient and I'm having this moral tension, this thing that I think wears at a lot of great young docs and the residents and students. They see this disparity and they go to the patient and you're thinking, and I'm thinking, run for your life. Get out of here. Just leave. Just pull out your IV and just run. Go. Just go to the next hospital. Or, the surgeon's on call. He does it all open, but there's another surgeon you can go see on your own and risk my own career and being on the chair's couch trying to explain a very tenuous political situation that I don't want to be in the middle of, in a field where your reputation is everything. And you learn the rules, and it's kind of like, look, this is the way we do it. I remember as an intern learning how to do colonoscopy. Sorry for the GI references here. I'm a GI surgeon, so we have a phrase that may be crap to you, but it's bread and butter to me. Okay. I was learning how to do colonoscopy. And there's a 6-minute withdrawal time, and you look at the inspect the cecum, you withdraw, and you look for polyps. It's known that 6 minutes is a standard time to maximize your polyp detection rate. So the guy was doing it, and he discovered a polyp. And this nice doctor, Dr. Cotman, I said, what are you going to do about this polyp? It looks precancerous. And he said, you know, these can be removed through the endoscope, but I'm just not good at doing it. Can you go and see if Dr. Smith's available next door? I went over, asked Dr. Smith, can you come in and help Dr. Cotman? He'd like to help you. He said, sure, came over right away. It was only in the room about 2 minutes. Said, oh yeah, give me a certain millimeter snare and lassoed the thing out with this metal clip. And the thing was removed. Tubular villous adenoma with a little carcinoma at the periphery, nothing at the stalk, nothing to do, precancerous polyp removed, the patient cured instantly with no other intervention. The patient woke up groggy from the anesthetic, elated. The next day, I was assigned to work with a different doc as you rotate as a trainee, and the doc discovered a similar polyp, and I asked him the same question. It was almost as if it was the same patient. What are you going to do about this polyp? And he said, you know, Marty, and I still remember these words like it was today, I just like to take these out with surgery. That's how I like to do it. And I thought, gosh, yesterday I just saw, and I asked him, I said, I kind of speak my mind, as you may see from Unaccountable. And I said, yesterday I was watching Dr. Cotman and he had me get Dr. Smith and he came in and removed, do you want me to see if Dr. Smith's available to come in and help with this? And he's like, Marty, let me tell you how it works. Wasn't angry because he was kind of like explaining to me how we do it in healthcare. Let me tell you how it works. This is the way I like to do it. This is my style. I have good results this way. This is my preference. And sure enough, the next day the patient underwent a big open sigmoid colon resection. The problem is not smaller today since I was a student. The problem is magnified. The Wild West of medicine is dominating the cost crisis. And people are getting crushed out there with their health insurance premiums. These deductibles are now bringing those voices to our office. When I'm telling somebody, you have a cancer, we need to get a CAT scan, their first question sometimes now is, how much does it cost? People are getting crushed out there. The average income in the United States is not what you and I earn. It's $42,000. That means half of America makes $42,000 or less. Now, when you have a $2,000 deductible, people are getting crushed out there, and they're getting crushed by all of the costs of these shenanigans getting passed on in the form of an actuarial science that builds it into the premiums. So when we talk about how lowering healthcare costs, it is not an easy problem. The problem is the endemic underlying variation, which is why, if I could mention real quick, the graphs that you're looking at are part of a new project that we've developed to create measures of appropriateness in medical care at the specialty level, specific to what you do. I mean, this graph here, cardiac stent rate by physician, looks at a physician's entire practice and the proportion of cardiac casts that they do where they decide to put a stent in. Now, I'm not a cardiologist, but they tell me a third or up to half of all stents are unnecessary. That's according to Bernard Laun, Nobel laureate, developed one of the pacemakers. Now, if he's right, and I don't know because I'm not a cardiologist, if he's right, half of stents are unnecessary, all you got to do is reduce this by 10% and you've wiped out the problem of medical inflation in the United States. We have finally been able to develop these measures. These are brand new. I don't think they've even been shown in public before. At the physician level, we have almost 50 measures now to look at ways to measure over-treatment, overuse in your practice in ways where the outliers have an indefensible practice pattern. So you can see there's a recommended range of the proportion of patients where you're going to need to put a stent in. Somewhere between 0 and 40 or 10 to 50% of patients you put a cath in for the first time, when you shoot the dye in, you're going to find a lesion that needs a stent. No matter how sick your patients are and all that stuff, we exclude all the emergencies and all the referrals that tertiary centers like mine get. These are elective cath procedures. Look at the number of people doing stents in almost every one of their patients, or 80% or 70% or 50%. The docs are telling us you would never put it in more than 50% of the time. A lot of times the answers in healthcare, I think, are simple. We just need to talk to the doctors. It's amazing what we can learn. I don't know any of these doctors that we've talked to, all the national leaders in the field, that tell us the policymakers have been developing metrics with their input. The proportion of patients you cut wide open versus do minimally invasive surgery for standardized conditions. We're not talking about weird pancreas operations like the ones I do. We're talking about standard colon operations, hysterectomy. These are some of the most common operations in the United States. It's the Wild West. Half of the patients get cut wide open and half the patients get the minimally invasive best practice. It's not the rural and urban disparities. You'd be surprised. Some of the best care in America is in some of our best rural hospitals. But we've graphed it now, and that's the graph over there. And we've got letters going out from these specialty associations there saying, hey, look, you're the red bar on the far end of the left. These are doctors that do 100% of their operations open. This is where you stand relative to the rest of the country. The C-section rate in the United States. Why are people doing 70, 80, 90% of their deliveries as a C-section? My patients are sicker. These are more high risk, maybe. The docs that developed these metrics with us have mathematically excluded all those high risk cases. By the way, the C-section rate at an urban Johns Hopkins hospital, 14%. C-section rate in the community hospital in the suburb, 40%. So it goes the opposite way. Why are you doing 90% C-sections when the national average is 10 to 20%. This is where the money is in healthcare. This is where the waste is. This is why people are getting crushed with healthcare costs in the United States. For the first time ever in history, we're able now to get the NPI numbers from the National Medicare data set and say to a doc, this is your practice pattern in all your practice. Historically, payers have fought. Medicare has fought. Medicaid has fought with doctors over individual cases, right? And it's an ugly battle. No winner. There's no winners in that war. This patient needed it, and they had pain, and, well, you know, this is a different approach. This is looking at extreme outlier practice patterns that nobody can justify. The last one, if I can just point that one out. Far left, on your right. Skin cancer, a very common problem in Florida, can be removed with something called Mohs surgery. The surgeon will make cuts to remove the cancer and then during the operation look at the edges of the tumor of the skin block to find out which edge may have tumor left and take an additional cut. That's called Mohs surgery. The surgeon gets paid a lot per cut. And the reason they get paid a lot is they're doing both the pathology analysis and the surgery. And you can whip them out quickly. You can make a lot of money doing Mohs surgery. Well, the Mohs surgeons in our focus group, by the way, these are all developed by the leaders in the field. I'm not coming up with these measures. They tell us there's an abuse where people are making too many cuts. You want to double your revenue, just increase the number of cuts for the standardized lesion. And you can start close to the tumor. That way you're not really increasing the total defect at the end. And you're not really leaving cancer behind because you know you're going to get it all eventually, but you just increase the number of cuts. We said we can now look at that in claims data. This is a graph of every surgeon in the United States that does that operation by their average number of cuts. And guess what you see? The national average is about 1.5 cuts in the course of a year that a surgeon will use to take out a skin tumor. We got docs doing 2, 3, 4 cuts on average, whereas the national average is 1.5. If they get a letter, which they're going to, which they received 2 weeks ago as a part of our program, first time in the United States this program has done this letter campaign, from the Association, American College of Mohs Surgeons, hey, this is where you stand, 3.5, this is where the national average is. Friendly letter, confidential, no punishment, no regulation, nobody goes to jail, no one's arrested. The letter writing campaign has demonstrated massive success. No anger. People, doctors are either silent, they're outliers, or they thank us for letting us know that their practice patterns are outdated or excessive. So this is the real, I think, the real issue in healthcare with costs. And the reason I'm excited to tell you about it is I really feel like we have cracked the code with healthcare costs.
Well, and that's interesting, but from our vantage point, there's another major issue that we deal with, and that is the hospital. That is the other major component of this. The whether a person's gallbladder or that hernia was resolved through laparoscopic surgery or through opening them up like a trout, as you said, has an adverse incentive. Because if the person does get complication, and I believe in the book you talk about how that young man did get complications, and he was in the hospital for several days, he acquired an infection, the hospital billed a tremendous amount more for that. So there, what is the incentive for the hospital to tell the doctor, you need to make less cuts, you need to be more efficient, and you need to train in laparoscopic surgery because we get better outcomes? Currently, the incentive for hospitals is to have you there longer.
The incentives are backwards, so they've been backwards, and we've known that, and it's a very frustrating problem. It's not that we have villains in healthcare. It's not that the hospital leaders are there saying, let's do more of the open, and that way we can bill more. No, it's just that, unfortunately, this kind of stuff that we're talking about relies on the moral case to do better, not the financial case. There's a moral incentive to improve, but there's not a financial incentive to improve. And the reason there hasn't been a financial incentive is no one has really been able to quantify things like that. No one's measured it. No one's come up with real value in healthcare, because when we talk about value-based payments, what's the quality that we're basing the payments on? Length of stay, patient satisfaction. I mean, these are old, primitive, and immature metrics that I think are sometimes unfair to docs. These are sound metrics. These are metrics I think will be at 100 measures now in almost every specialty in healthcare. We just came up with one meeting with all the orthopedic and neurosurgeons around spine surgery. The proportion of lumbar operations for back pain where you put in hardware, there's an appropriate range, and then there's outliers. And guess what? The outliers are very expensive, and they're very dangerous out there. They're expensive to the Medicaid $20+ billion budget. This is a granular level that's never been looked at. We're looking at it now with a bunch of large payers. We're looking at it with CMS. We'd love to look at it with Florida. But that hospital incentive has not been there traditionally to say, we will reward you for improving quality, for doing that case laparoscopic instead of open. And that's been a real dilemma. But I think these measures will dominate healthcare eventually.
How does that change the, you talk in the book about the separation between hospital management and the people actually doing the work. And I want to get to surveys in a minute because that's an important part, and Chairman Sprouls has some legislation about that. Because ultimately we have to take some action, and sometimes our actions aren't the right ones to take. But to the degree that we can be involved and help in this, we want to. The current hospital setting is a CON-protected setting. And hospitals have become these conglomerates that take over diagnostic centers. They take over doctors' offices. The management is, of course, interested in what management is interested in, which is creating profits, and I don't fault them for it. How do we turn the incentives? Where will management feel like, well, if you do less cuts, it's better for me, or if you do more laparoscopic, it's better for me? How do we do that?
We would never think it's reasonable for the food industry to compete in supermarkets with claims like better for you or healthier without a food label, would we? We have decided, those of us that believe in the free market and those of us that believe in letting the free market govern the consumer marketplace, that we have to create a standard so that competition can occur. And that standard has been food labels, a standardized label that tells you what's in it. And that little creation of a standard has allowed that market to compete. And guess what now? When people go shopping, they're looking at, this has 28 grams of sugar, that has 8 grams of sugar. They're looking at, this has 15 ingredients I can't pronounce, and this has 3 ingredients I can pronounce. That's what we need in healthcare. Right now we have competition, but the competition is at the wrong level at hospitals. They're competing on billboards, reputations, ads in magazines. And, you know, I had a patient the other day. I asked them, why'd you decide to come here to Johns Hopkins? They said, well, the parking was better. Okay, we're like competing on valet parking with the university across the street. I mean, what kind? We're providing great state of the art healthcare. We need to get these measures out there in the market so that a patient can see that this guy's putting in hardware in 100% of his back operations and this guy is not. This person is treating every patient with heartburn with Nexium and proton pump inhibitors, and this guy's treating about half his patients or her patients with heartburn. I was on that stuff. I was on Nexium, and then the study came out that it can cause stroke and renal failure after I was told it was safe. And you better believe I got myself off right away, and I said to my GI doc, who's the head of GI at Johns Hopkins, I said, I'm getting off this thing. I don't care if I got to live with heartburn. I don't want renal failure and stroke. I already have kind of memory lapses as it is, and I think I got Alzheimer's and dementia and Parkinson's already wrapped together. And he said, just come off, but you get the alternative. I said, what's the alternative? He said, well, the safest medication is something called lifestyle modification. Now, I like a Shake Shack, but I'll tell you, doing this lifestyle modification has meant I don't need any medications and I feel great. Sometimes we need to stop throwing money at these problems that can be better treated with better medicine and better prevention than to say, and we've never been able to measure this, but now with these appropriateness measures that we're developing, we're looking at how many injections are you doing in an eye after macular degeneration as an ophthalmologist compared to the rest of the country? Are you doing one every visit for 2 years? Or are you doing one or two, which is the national average? This has been off the radar, unmeasurable, and now for the first time it's measurable.
All right, so from our standpoint, we are not just a payer, we're a major payer of healthcare, but we're also representatives of the people. But let's talk for a second about the people. So this is the one aspect of this that could help. Because when we talk about competition in the supermarket or buying cars, it's the consumer that engages in it. It's the consumer that creates that market condition. But if you go to a doctor, the culture is that if I go see you and you say you need surgery, unless I'm really afraid of surgery, it's almost offensive, or I feel like it's offensive to say, I'm going to go get a second opinion. And so people don't. if someone prescribes Nexium or anything else. I have no way of knowing. And it's what used to happen with cars, where you take it to the mechanic and they tell you you need a new transmission. You don't know what transmission is, and so you don't know what that meant. So how do we put that component in play?
You know, doctors are very interesting people. We respond to peer comparison. We respond to the honor of being a part of your medical care. So when a patient comes and says to me, "Doctor, I heard you're the best for this and I wanted to get your opinion," we like to weigh in. People need to get a second opinion. 20% of second opinions are different from the first opinion. So I tell everybody, look, if you're going to be on a medication every day for the rest of your life with a cost, a daily cost and a cost to the system, or you need a big operation, unless you're in an emergent situation, get a second opinion. Why? Because 20 or 30% sometimes of the second opinions are different from the first. There's a program that flies patients from one employer to a major hospital in the United States to get a second opinion. And 20% of the time, that opinion is you never need it. You don't need the surgery at all. Well, employers are saying, I want to be a part of this program because I'm self-funded. My insurance is a self-funded insurance plan. I want to figure out how I can save money from unnecessary. Get a second opinion. They have telemedicine second opinions now. I have no financial relationship. They have all kinds of you can see the other doc in your town. You can, my cousin practices GI in Boca, and he tells me there's a lot of GI groups there and a lot of different opinions. There's so many GI groups, you can get a second opinion by walking less than 10 blocks from the first opinion. There's so many opportunities to get a second opinion. People say, well, it's out of my insurance network. I tell them, look, it's worth it to pay cash for all the things you're going to spend $200 for. $330 would be the most expensive evaluation and management billing code for anybody that accepts Medicare. And oftentimes they use that same case rate anyway. $300 to get a good second opinion on what might be a medication you're going to take every day for the rest of your life that you may not need, or a knee operation that you were told you needed, but the second opinion tells you, and this is true, a New England Journal of Medicine randomized controlled trial showed that for most types of osteoarthritis of the knee, physical therapy and pain management is better than knee replacement. That's not my opinion. That's the New England Journal of Medicine randomized controlled trial that just came out. Similar trial for diverticulitis and colon removal, showing it's unnecessary. Three trials in the last 2 years in our top journals, New England Journal of Medicine, JAMA, and Annals of Surgery, showing that if you have appendicitis, run-of-the-mill appendicitis, about a quarter of the people here have had it, and if not your kids probably, can be treated with antibiotics 80% of the time. If they don't get better the next day, they can go for surgery, or if it comes back in the next couple of weeks or months, they can have surgery that time. And if they do that surgery, on the back end, it doesn't affect outcomes at all. It's not worse. It's not harder. It's not necessarily a worse outcome in any statistical analysis in any of the three studies. Do you think people are getting antibiotics for appendicitis when they walk into emergency rooms today in America?
No.
I've talked to surgeons. Hey, what about antibiotics for appendicitis? Have you tried using this new? By the way, the evidence is ample. If it's almost unethical to do more research, there's like tons of research now on it. I had a patient come in. I was on call for the emergency room, and I had a patient come in. And the study came out. We're going to give you antibiotics. Patient went home the next day. Another patient came in. Did the same thing. Another patient came in, same thing. Four patients. The last guy had a wedding the next morning in Boston. And I thought, gosh, do we do the surgery right now so you can get to your wedding? Or do we give you the antibiotics right now and that'll get you to the wedding faster? We gave him the antibiotics. Next day, it was no symptoms. This is the problem of unwarranted clinical variation. We can measure that now. We can measure how often in your practice you give antibiotics. One of the patients, by the way, followed up with another surgeon, I guess for a second opinion, and they said, oh, you had appendicitis? We need to take you to surgery. They took him to surgery, even though they had no pain.
So as a payer, we don't want, we generally, as a more conservative body, don't like to create law where we don't need to and be cumbersome about it. And so we don't want to get in between that relationship of a patient and a doctor. But as a payer, certainly if there was anything else we'd be buying in our personal lives, wouldn't it be okay for us to say, if you remove appendix that is paid by the state, or if you remove gallbladders paid by the state, you must do it laparoscopically? I mean, at what point do we allow people to continue to practice the way that they practice because it's either beneficial to them, the incentives aren't in the right place, and it's beneficial to the hospital? Why is that okay? Why isn't there standardization that says starting July, whatever, there is no more cutting a patient open like a trout for standard gallbladder removal?
The liberty we hold closely as physicians to customize treatments to an individual patient's goals and situation, because every patient's a little different, that is important. That's an important liberty. And I think we as physicians are right to guard that liberty. I've done a lot of work in geriatrics. You know, an 80-year-old is not an 80-year-old. Everyone's different, different goals, different settings, different risk, different boundaries of what's normal, different definitions of what's quality life. I appreciate that liberty. I guard it too. And you're right. As the state does not want to get into that very difficult art form. It's a craft that I'm proud of. But these outlier practice patterns that are indefensible, we need to do something. Doing open surgery on every patient who's an ideal candidate for minimally invasive surgery, we need to do something, and something beyond inject the state into the physician's office. What is that? I believe information is powerful. And if there's a way that the appropriateness measures can either be available to patients online. By the way, if patients don't look at it online, which is a common experience out there with states and all kinds of publicly available data, the third-party startup healthcare companies, healthcare is the fastest area of startup in San Francisco and in the United States, they will extract that data and make it available to patients in a simple way for patient navigation. They do that well. And they're doing it already. They're just doing it with bad data. If appropriateness measures, for example, or how often a surgeon will do an open versus appropriate minimally invasive surgery is either public information or shared individually with the surgeon, this is where you stand, this is where the rest of the country stands. You know, there's the minimally invasive surgery graph for colon. We have a graph for hysterectomy and back surgery and ophthalmology and cardiology, all the expensive things in healthcare that are commonly overdone, according to the specialists. This is what they tell us. We can say, hey, this is where you fall. This is where the rest of the state falls. I agree. We don't want to regulate. We don't want to get and put the state in the doctor's office. Trust me, I operate 3 to 4 days a week. I value that doctor-patient relationship. But do we have an ethical duty to do something about these extreme outliers now that for the first time in history we can measure them? I think when you're looking at a state budget that's a quarter, a third expenditure on paying claims, it's totally reasonable to say we want to know what the patterns are within these claims. And if you're an outlier practice pattern, we're either going to let you know, or in the case of Mohs surgery, they've said, look, we're going to let the doctors know confidentially with a friendly data sharing. And if the extreme outliers are still extreme outliers in a year and they haven't provided some explanation, which they're invited to do, by the way, then that those outliers are going to be made public, because we may have a moral obligation to do something about the poor folks that are walking in blind to see these dangerous and expensive doctors.
Well, and along that line, and you talked about the nutritional label. So without intruding in that, but in protecting patients' rights, which we do exhaustively with their information that is not nearly as secretive or as delicate as we make it, but we protect it, and that's great. It causes other difficulties, as you know, between doctors' offices, but nevertheless. But what about patients' rights in regards to knowing what that doctor's nutritional label is? So would it be okay to say a patient coming to see you has to see this data from you? They have to, in all of the paperwork you make them fill out, and I want to talk about that a second because gag orders is something you mentioned in the book, but would it be feasible to say, if I arrive at a doctor's office, I get to see along all his paperwork a report card. This is the way that he performs these surgeries. This is the national average for these surgeries. Whatever data we've gathered from him, shouldn't they have to have something that gives them some understanding of what they're walking into?
I think that makes all the sense in the world. I mean, the question is, what happens to outliers when they're forced to see their data or respond to their data being publicly available? Invariably, and this is scientifically been shown time and time again, peer comparison moves the outliers right into the mean. We are very competitive creatures, doctors. If you haven't, met pre-med students in college, let me tell you, we are very competitive. And we're competing for a good goal, to help people. But we can outperform anybody if we put our mind to it. Peer comparison works. People move right to the mean. Now, I can tell you that a patient is looking at some data now when they look at their doctor, just because I Googled myself and I have like 5 stars from health grades. I was all excited until I realized it's based on one reviewer. Okay. They're looking at information now. They're just not looking at valuable information. Now, I can make somebody like Hodad feel totally satisfied and happy with their experience, even though they had a horrible complication of an operation they probably didn't need. People have information, but these companies, all the physician navigation tools that are trying to help patients navigate to hospitals, are using bad data. They should be using appropriateness measures that doctors endorse. Doctors came up with this. This is not a policy group or a government agency or a consulting firm. Doctors develop these metrics based on the outlier patterns that they see in their own field. Good doctors. Now, let me tell you, the cardiologists are ticked off that a small fraction of cardiologists out there are giving their field a bad reputation. I mean, cardiology is an amazing specialty, what they can do. The technology, they save lives, heart disease is way down. And a small group of cardiologists that are extreme outliers, costing the system millions and millions of dollars, are creating a stereotype now that when a person meets a cardiologist at a cocktail party, they say, I heard about these unnecessary stents. It might be, they're upset. They want to rein in their own house. Can a patient get information without burdening the doctor with an added regulation or reporting requirement? Because I'll tell you, doctors and hospitals, and this is not the fault of the state of Florida, we're getting crushed with reporting requirements. Just everything, just forms and hiring people that just do these reporting forms. Can we have a zero addition to the reporting requirement by physicians and hospitals? Yes, we can. Why? This data lives in your all-payer state database. This data lives in the New York all-payer state database and the California all-payer state database and the Medicare CMS national database. Now, Medicare is just people over 65. We could work with you to show you the extreme outliers in Florida from the CMS data that we have special access to with the doctored NPI number and everything. But we don't have people under 65, which is where a lot of the unnecessary open hysterectomies are. There's another metric that we've developed, but I would say the specialists in the field, removing the ovaries for no reason during hysterectomy, It's an old practice to prevent ovarian cancer. They figure if I'm in there, I'm just going to take out the ovaries among people that are post-childbearing but premenopausal. Well, guess what? God made the ovaries for a reason. They produce important hormones that are cardioprotective and affect all sorts of things from mood, sex drive, and all sorts of function. So the old practice that you're in there, I'm just going to take them out to prevent ovarian cancer, is a practice that we can identify patterns on it with our appropriateness measures. None of these measures have ever been collected, but yes, I think in terms of things that I think there's broad consensus on, not just my own personal opinion, but yes, it also includes my own personal opinion as a practicing physician. What can we do with zero added regulatory requirements at the physician and hospital level? What can we do that's meaningful to patients? What can we do that's respectful of confidentiality? And what can we do that allows the free market to compete on things that matter as opposed to claims that are don't have any food labels?
So one last thing, because it's before us, and then we'll take questions. Chair Sprouls has legislation that deals with the culture. It's a culture survey for hospitals. Tell us how that was developed and how you think that that can be helpful.
Well, it's really cool. I think, you know, if you look at how we find a doctor for things. Now, you're a picture of health. You probably don't need doctors. For me, I'm going to a doctor for every little thing, you know, earache and dry eyes from the airports. And none of you have ever been delayed in an airport, but I've experienced that, I'm sure. So the old way of finding a doctor we've been using for centuries is we talk to a lot of people. I talk to scrub nurses and say, this guy you scrub into surgery with, how is he technically as a surgeon? Anesthesiologist, when you're looking over the curtain, you know, how good of a surgeon is she? These are the questions you and I ask. We talk to leaders. We talk to clinical directors. We talk to hospital leaders, folks with national. We do a lot of research. But once again, most of the people in the United States are walking in blind with good intentions. Can we provide the same wisdom that we have access to by talking to everybody, to the everyday consumer, so we have competition at an appropriate level? And the thing I love about Chairman Sprouls' legislation with this idea of a safety culture survey is that hospitals are already asking their employees, would you go here for your own medical care? Is it safe in your unit? Just a couple simple questions. They're already collecting this information in most hospitals in the United States. Why? Because they know it's valuable. By the way, they're paying a third party to get this information sometimes. Can we make that available to the public? Does the public have a right to know about the quality of their local community hospital? I believe they do. If there's this information that's out there, or if we can simply ask them, if they're not already doing the survey that most hospitals are already doing, can we simply ask employees in a simple survey about the safety here? Would you go here for your own care? Do you feel comfortable speaking up if you perceive a safety problem? That's a very telling question about a hospital. Those are the questions we ask our colleagues when we need care for ourselves. It's a very common sense thing that creates a food label so that the market can function, I believe, at the right level without creating an added burden.
Good. I'm down on the bill. So I think we've got a microphone that we can pass out if anybody has any questions. Representative Spano.
Thank you for being here, Doctor. We appreciate your valuable input and advice. My question is, to what extent, if any, do you have an opinion on the drug manufacturing or medical product industry, their impact on cost rises, and what, if anything, can we do to keep those costs down?
Great question. It's a tough problem. It's a really difficult problem, and I think one of the we need good medications out there, and I've seen these medications save lives. We want the pharma industry to develop good medications, but we also want to prevent the price gouging that we saw with Martin Shkreli, right? I mean, that guy was the poster child for everything wrong with greed in industry. How do you regulate greed? I mean, it's so hard, right? I think it's almost impossible. I mean, you saw the Affordable Care Act, I'm very objective with things in it. Now, I don't have a strong partisan leaning either way. I try to talk specifically about impact, like the CBO would talk about impact. Affordable Care Act tried to get at the greed, and the authors acknowledge this backfired, by the way. This is not a partisan statement. By regulating the profit an insurance company could take from the premium, regulating 80% goes to the claim payout and 20% can be kept for administrative or other costs. Well, guess what happened? Premiums, there was an incentive to just increase the premiums. That's how you make more money. And that was part of the what people believe to be a small driver, but one of the drivers of the premium. Very hard to regulate that. How do you regulate these guys like Martin? Very difficult to get at it. I think the bigger issue is that my doctor put me on Nexium when I didn't need it. I think the bigger issue is that you have Avastin and Lucentis, two drugs for macular degeneration. One costs $2,000 an injection. The other costs about $48 an injection. Equal clinical effectiveness. One of the appropriateness measures is looking at practice patterns. Are you always using Lucentis? Or are you using it in a mix that represents the national average or the state average? So it's a difficult problem, and I know it's one that's frustrating people, but it's a tough one to get at.
Thank you so very much. Can you speak a little bit on cost drivers relative to medical malpractice insurance and the cost, what happens in defensive medicine and perhaps procedures being done, that MRI every time you have a headache because at this time it could be a tumor and you could be dead tomorrow. So if you could really address those cost drivers as well.
Trust me, this is an issue close to my heart. I've never been sued in court, but there's been a patient or two over the last 15 years of my practice that has made some frivolous claim, and it wears on you as a doctor. You feel almost betrayed to the group you're trying to help. There's nothing that unites every physician in the United States except for two things: more doctor pay and getting at medical malpractice with common sense reforms. But the true analysis, and this has been done study after study, there's not a lot of money there for the whole system. Now, in certain fields, they're getting hammered. OB, neurosurgery, you can't even find neurosurgeons now to work in rural areas. So it is creating an access disparity problem that's a really big problem. But in terms of the unnecessary MRI, even though you're getting billed up to $7,000 for the MRI, the true cost to that facility is often in the hundreds. And it goes both ways. People avoid operations because they're concerned about the medical malpractice risk. That is, we surgeons sometimes will look at a high-risk case and just shy away because they're on the border of what's indicated, and we just shy away because the patient is, showing all kinds of signs that they are not really on board, they don't really understand the operation, they're father is the president of the Lawyers Association. You know, there are all these indicators that can sometimes scare off doctors to say, because of the malpractice risk, I might avoid delivering care. So all in all, it's been estimated that it accounts for 0.3%, 0.3% of the entire $800 billion Medicare expenditure. And I think that's probably in the ballpark.
Chair Broder's here. He's
good
chairman
to see you
of
again.
Healthcare Appropriations.
Thank you very much, and thank you for being here. With all of the new data that's coming out and some of the issues that we've discussed, have you contemplated yet how long it may take until we get to a future whereby we can pay for wellness instead of the procedures? Reversing that kind of perverse incentive of when you walk in, we need to cut you or admit you or scan you or something so we can get paid, but rather a system by which, as a payer, we may be able to start paying for wellness instead of sickness.
I love the concept. The challenge is, and you hear about this all the time, value-based healthcare. You hear about it all the time, and it's big with the payers in Florida. It's big nationally. It's the buzzword. It's big in the ivory tower, where, you know, they're looking down saying we need to move to value-based healthcare. Who the heck is actually measuring value? How do you measure value? No one has good measures of wellness, of value, of quality. What are we using? Mortality, length of stay, and patient satisfaction, and a central line associated infection? I haven't seen one of those in 5 years. Look at all the preventable harm that the doctors are telling us about if we just ask them. All these measures developed after just months and months of multiple meetings with the national experts and specialists and community doctors. I've mentioned we pulled a bunch of them from the Boca area, provided great insights that we didn't get from academics. On where the over-treatment is, where the abuse, where. So we feel like we have created finally the appropriateness measures so we can actually make payment value-based. But the reality is we're not gonna change the healthcare payment model overnight, but payers love these appropriateness measures. And they're starting to say, how can we incorporate this? We've already worked with 3 large systems to apply these metrics, and they're looking at it. It's all civil. We're not embarrassing any doctor. At most, they get to see where they stand. But you can better believe that doctors do not want to be outliers. So I think we're finally getting to value in healthcare, and I think that's, you know, one idea maybe we can think about is you are a very large payer. You're a $26 billion payer. There's that much money that you're spending on these outlier practice patterns. Do we have an obligation, not just our own fiscal obligation, but a moral obligation to say, can we address these outliers? Can we share the data, make it confidential, send a simple report? These reports on the outside, on the outermost area, those are the actual reports that go to the doctors in those 2 pilot programs. And, you know, would it be reasonable to let extreme outliers know you are 2 standard deviations out of the mean with a metric that's been endorsed by your own professional association and developed with experts at Johns Hopkins in an effort funded by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation? And the analytics have been done by Oliver Wyman. Jim here is with Oliver Wyman. If you want to just raise your hand, he's been working with us on it, so I want to thank him.
Well, Doctor, we know you've got other meetings you want to get to. We thank you so much for joining us, and we hope that as we continue this conversation, you'll stay engaged with us and advise us along the way. We don't want to overstep, but we also, as a major payer, want to make sure that to the degree that we can help bring some of these things to light, we can. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chair Oliva. I really enjoyed it. Thank you.